Good morning, and thank you all for traveling to Washington, D.C. to participate in this counter-ISIS-Daesh ministerial conference. It is indeed encouraging to see the attendance. When the forces of ISIS and Daesh tune into their TVs and their computer monitors, they will see the strength of a combined 68 nations and organizations. Together we share a resolve to deal ISIS or Daesh a lasting defeat. Our coalition is united in stopping an ISIS resurgence, halting its global ambitions, and discrediting its ideological narrative. And we're ready to grow stronger and stay aggressive in this battle. President Trump, in his recent address to the joint session of Congress, made clear that it is the policy of the United States to demolish and destroy this barbaric terrorist organization. That is what we are going to do. Many of us here today represent countries who know ISIS's carnage firsthand. In fact, today marks 1 year since 32 innocent people were killed and 300 wounded in attacks in Brussels. The Belgian foreign minister is home commemorating this solemn day for his country, but we are grateful to have the ambassador from our ally Belgium joining us today. In the same month as the attack in Brussels, a child was killed and 600 Iraqis were injured in an ISIS chemical weapons attack in Taza, just south of Kirkuk. ISIS has carried out horrific attacks in the streets of Paris and Istanbul, each planned from its headquarters in Raqqa. The United States has also experienced attacks inspired by ISIS on social media, a phenomenon we are working to combat together and which will be a major point of discussion among us today. As we commemorate and mourn for the victims of ISIS's hatred, let us also honor them with unwavering dedication to victory. The great commonality among we who have gathered today is a commitment to bringing down a global force of evil. And I emphasize the word commitment. The success of our mission depends on a continual devotion to our stated objective of defeating this terrorist organization. In the run-up to this meeting, we identified over $2 billion in humanitarian stabilization and demining needs for liberated areas in Iraq and Syria for 2017. I'm pleased to announce that we have surpassed that total in dollar pledges. Let's fulfill our pledges so we can quickly disperse the funds we need to carry out operations for the rest of the year. Reflecting on the past year or so, we should be encouraged by the significant progress we as a coalition are making. In addition to the latest meaningful financial contributions, the flow of foreign terrorist fighters into Syria and Iraq is down 90% over the past year. It is harder for terrorists to get in, and more importantly, harder for them to get out to threaten our homelands. Turkey has pushed ISIS off the Turkey-Syria border through Operations Euphrates Shield. This entire border is now inaccessible to ISIS, and we will ensure that it stays that way. Nearly all of Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi's deputies are now dead, including the mastermind behind the attacks in Brussels, Paris, and elsewhere. It is only a matter of time before Baghdadi himself meets this same fate. The Libyan government of National Accord aligned fighters from Misrata routed ISIS in Sirte, depriving ISIS of its only territory outside of Iraq and Syria. We are pleased to have representatives of the Libyan government with us here today. In Iraq and Syria, our partners on the ground have liberated 50,000 square kilometers of territory from ISIS, freeing nearly 2.5 million people in cities, villages, and towns. Most importantly, the liberation of all of this territory has held. ISIS has recovered none of it. 17 coalition members are producing content in 5 languages to counteract ISIS's propaganda and its attack on its online presence. These efforts have yielded a 75% reduction of ISIS content on the internet in 1 year, and the takedown of 475,000 ISIS-linked Twitter accounts. In Iraq, more than 1.5 million Iraqis have now returned to their homes and areas that had been under control of ISIS. The displacement flow outward has been reversed, and this is a trend we must ensure continues. And neighboring countries closest to the conflict, like Jordan, Turkey, and Lebanon, have undertaken a widespread humanitarian response to the regional refugee crisis, including the acceptance of millions of refugees, many of whom they are working to reintegrate into normal life in their own nations. We especially should recognize the Republic of Iraq. Prime Minister Abadi, who is with me on stage, has shown commitment and courage, often visiting the front lines to encourage his troops and ensure that people are being cared for after the battles. His desire for stability and inclusive governance drives his vision for the future of Iraq. The ongoing Iraqi-led retaking of Mosul is pushing ISIS out of a key stronghold and liberating more than a million civilians. Iraqi forces, many trained by our coalition, are performing heroically and placing protection of civilians at the forefront of their military plan. This Mosul campaign could not have succeeded without the cooperation between the Iraqi security forces and the Kurdish Peshmerga. I am pleased to see a representative from Kurdistan Regional Government, Mr. Fuad Hussein, here today with Prime Minister Abadi. It is this close cooperation between the Iraqi people and their leaders that hastens ISIS's ultimate defeat and ensures it can never return to Iraq. Hard-fought victories in Iraq and Syria have swung the momentum in our coalition's favor. But we must increase the intensity of our efforts and solidify our gains in the next phase of the counter-ISIS fight. Degradation of ISIS is not the end goal. We must defeat ISIS. I recognize there are many pressing challenges in the Middle East, but defeating ISIS is the United States' number one goal in the region. As we've said before, when everything is a priority, nothing is a priority. We must continue to keep our focus on the most urgent matter at hand. At this moment, we are still in a phase characterized by major military operations. The expansion of ISIS has necessitated a large-scale military response, and our offensive measures are reclaiming areas in Iraq and Syria in which ISIS has had a large and destructive footprint. Our end goal in this phase is the regional elimination of ISIS through military force. The military power of the coalition will remain where this fraudulent caliphate has existed in order to set the conditions for a full recovery from the tyranny of ISIS. Under President Trump's leadership and with the strength of this historic coalition, our common enemy will remain under intense pressure. Soon, our efforts in Iraq and Syria will enter a new phase, defined by a transition from major military operations to stabilization. In this transition to the stabilization phase, our coalition will continue to clear landmines and return water and electricity, the basic elements that permit people to return to their homes. We will pursue regional diplomatic solutions for the underlying political and sectarian disputes that helped ISIS to flourish. The coalition and future partners will continue to provide humanitarian assistance to affected communities as necessary. We appreciate the work of the UN-managed funding facility for immediate stabilization, which has helped Iraq return home over 500,000 displaced persons in Anbar province alone. Continuing coalition support for police training will be essential, as will be coalition support for demining and clearing hazardous materials. We will continue to facilitate the return of people to their homes and work with local political leadership. They will provide stable and fair governance, rebuild infrastructure, and provide the essential services. We will use our diplomatic presence on the ground to facilitate channels of dialogue between local leadership and coalition partners. These initiatives are working well in Iraq, and we are working to tailor a similar approach specific to the challenges in Syria. While a more defined course of action in Syria is still coming together, I can say the United States will increase our pressure on ISIS and al-Qaeda, and will work to establish interim zones of stability through ceasefires to allow refugees to go home. As a coalition, we are not in the business of nation building, or reconstruction. We must ensure that our respective nations' precious and limited resources are devoted to preventing the resurgence of ISIS and equipping the war-torn communities to take the lead in rebuilding their institutions and returning to stability. A successful stabilization period will improve daily life for millions of people. Today, in East Mosul, stabilization projects are clearing rubble, clearing landmines, restoring water services and electricity, and nearly 30,000 boys and girls are now back in school. These efforts are being led by Iraqis locally, in cooperation with the central government under the leadership of Prime Minister Abadi. A successful stabilization phase will set the stage for a successful normalization phase. In the normalization phase, local leaders and local governments will take on the process of restoring their communities in the wake of ISIS with our support. The development of a rejuvenated civil society in these places will lead to a disenfranchisement of ISIS and the emergence of stability and peace where there was once chaos and suffering. But none of this will happen automatically. We all need to support this effort. To date, in Iraq and Syria, the United States provides 75% of the military resources supporting our local partners in their fight against ISIS. For humanitarian and stabilization support, the ratio is reversed, with the United States providing 25% and the rest of the coalition providing 75%. The United States will do its part, but the circumstances on the ground require more from all of you. I ask each country to examine how it can best support these vital stabilization efforts, especially in regard to contribution to military and financial resources. As we stabilize areas encompassing ISIS's physical caliphates in Iraq and Syria, we also must prevent their seeds of hatred from taking root elsewhere. The loss of territory in Iraq and Syria has forced ISIS to extend its current branches and build new bases of operations in countries around the world. Already, we are seeing ISIS-linked cells from the Pacific Rim to Central Asia to South America. Just this month, dozens of people were killed and wounded when members of ISIS, disguised as doctors, attacked a hospital in Kabul, Afghanistan. We know military strength will stop ISIS on a battlefield, but it is the combined strength of our coalition that will be the final blow to ISIS. In order to stay ahead of a global outbreak, we must all adopt the following countermeasures. First, continue to persist with in-country counterterrorism and law enforcement operations. All of us must maintain pressure on ISIS's networks within our own countries and take decisive law enforcement action to stop its growth. ISIS is connected across every continent, and we must work to break every link in its chain. Interpol is the newest member of our coalition and is critical to closing all routes through which ISIS terrorists seek to travel and threaten our homelands. Second, we need greater intelligence and information sharing within our own domestic intelligence agencies and among our nations. Our information sharing as a coalition has prevented a number of attacks, and this must expand and accelerate, regardless of departmental or international rivalries. One example of this is West African nations who have put aside national differences to combat Boko Haram. Let us build on this good example. We also must look this enemy's ideology in the eyes for what it is, a warped interpretation of Islam that threatens all of our people. As His Majesty King Abdullah II of Jordan has recently said, and I quote, "Everything they are, everything they do, is a blatant violation of my faith," end quote. ISIS fighters are not all from poor or impoverished communities. Many come from middle class or even upper class backgrounds, drawn to a radical and false utopian vision that purports to be based upon the Quran. Muslim partners and leaders of their faith must combat this perverse ideological message, and we are grateful that so many have and are ready to take up this responsibility. Lastly, in tandem with our aggressive pushback on the ground in multiple countries, We must break ISIS's ability to spread its message and recruit new followers online. A digital caliphate must not flourish in the place of a physical one. As we have seen from attacks in Nice, Berlin, Orlando, and San Bernardino, the internet is ISIS's best weapon for turning a recruit into a self-radicalized attacker. As traveling to Iraq and Syria as a fighter has become more difficult, ISIS's new call has become, and I quote, "Stay where you are, wage war in Daesh's name, wherever you live." ISIS's handlers around the world spend their days at keyboard communicating with a would-be terrorist, methodically feeding a recruit's deranged desire to develop local networks or carry out attacks in their own countries. We are making progress, but we need to do more to attack this threat. Our coalition's 24/7 counter-messaging hubs in the UAE, the UK, and Malaysia are having an impact, and these types of efforts should be replicated and expanded elsewhere. Counter-messaging efforts should continue both in the online arena and on the ground in countries where religious leaders have opportunities to speak out against radicalization. Our Muslim partners, particularly Saudi Arabia and Egypt, have important roles to play in combating the message of ISIS and other radical Islamic terrorist groups. We all should deepen cooperation with the tech industry to prevent encrypted technologies from serving as tools that enable extremist collaboration. We need the global tech industry to develop new advancements in the fight, and we thank those companies which are already responding to this challenge. We must capitalize on the extraordinary advancements in data analytics and algorithmic technologies to build tools that discover ISIS's propaganda and identify imminent attacks. Researchers in the United States are already developing tools for sweeping the dark corners of the internet for ISIS material, but they need help to get to their destination even faster. Later on, we will hear at lunch from Ali Jaber, who will speak in great detail on how to achieve victory in this arena. But let me be clear, we must fight ISIS online as aggressively as we would on the ground. In closing, ISIS presents an ongoing challenge to our collective security. But as we have seen, it is not more powerful than we are when we stand together. We must thwart ISIS as it tries to maintain a presence on the ground and in cyberspace. We must enhance cooperation in border security, aviation security, law enforcement, financial sanctions, counter-messaging, and intelligence sharing. And we must keep making the investment in liberated areas in Iraq and Syria to help innocent people rebuild and stabilize their communities. Right now, this means continuing to clear explosives, restore water and power, deliver humanitarian and resettlement assistance, and forge partnerships with local leaders who reject extremism. Our time today is an opportunity for the open and honest exchange of information and encouragement. As allies dedicated to defeating a common enemy, we should strive to understand and respect one another's perspectives and adopt the ideas that will achieve our mission. Most of all, now is the time to strengthen our shared commitment to security and invest in a fight in which we all have a stake. Thank you very much. As I mentioned in my remarks, our next speaker is a leader who has been a courageous ally in this fight. His army has shown bravery and persistence against a fierce enemy. And we admire his people, who, though they have suffered, are resolute in their commitment to throw off tyranny. Please join me in welcoming Prime Minister Abadi of Iraq.
In the name of God, most compassionate, most merciful, Secretary Tillerson, Your Excellencies, heads of delegations, ladies and gentlemen, peace of God be upon you. Since our previous meeting for the Global Coalition, in this coalition against Daesh, we have achieved many great victories. We were able to achieve all these victories by cooperating together and the brave fighting of the Iraqis on the ground, a fighting that went from south of Baghdad to its western part, and today we're fighting with bravery in Mosul. Before coming to this meeting in Washington, I was in Mosul, visited the front lines, found the Arab fighting side by side with the Kurd and the Christian with the Muslim and with the Yazidi and the Chebki and the Turkman. All of them believe steadfastly in the unity of Iraq and in the common determination and destiny for all against an enemy that wanted to break us apart and kill the minorities among us and to exclude a large part of the Iraqi society and communities and drive them out of their cities. Our common and one-front response is an indicator of the failure of the efforts of Daesh. We are now undertaking all the efforts to make sure the displaced return to their cities and their villages, and we are trying to stabilize the liberated areas and stabilize many of these cities and villages.
أكثر من 70% من سكان مدينة الفلوجة
of the residents of Fallujah, the city of Fallujah and Ramadi, and more than 90% of the city of Tikrit have returned to their homes thanks to the efforts of stabilization and the return of all the necessary and essential services. Ladies and gentlemen, you know the impact of the economic situation and the drop down of oil prices, while we also fight this very ferocious fight that cost us very much as well. Despite all of that, and thank be to God, we were able to return stability to many regions, even in Mosul, as we fight against ISIS and Daesh and terrorism. We are at the same time simultaneously stabilizing, and we have opened 250 schools in the left side of Mosul, while the ongoing fight in the right side of the city. We also opened many hospitals, many medical centers, and we have tried hard to provide services to the citizens while we fight at the same time and fight the enemies, while also the enemies try to provide otherwise. This is the Iraq that we are trying to build, and we are very proud of our diversity in our unified country, and we are united within the boundaries of our country. Today, as we fight ISIS in the final stages militarily in Iraq, and we have given them very harsh blows to this enemy, we fought also the slogan of ISIS as if they pretend to build an empire and pretend to expand this empire. We prove today that this empire that they tried to build is today very much on the decrease, and we are trying to liberate today Mosul that they attempted to make as their own capital. We also sent a very strong message to the young that they try to appeal to. We see many Daesh members being killed, and many those who try to get recruited with ISIS, are on the decrease. We broke many of their dreams. Today, for that reason, Daesh is resorting to many terrorist attacks in Afghanistan, Pakistan, Iraq, and many other places in Europe, in order to send a message that they are still standing, and they want for those young people to go for
الانتصار اليوم اللي حققناه على داعش انتصار كبير. نحن الآن في مرحلة القضاء على داعش وليس احتوائها. كنا نسمع في السابق كلام حول احتواء داعش. احتواء داعش أمر خطير لا يجوز أن نقبل به بتاتا. هذه منظمة إرهابية لا تؤتمن على شيء. لا يمكن التعامل معها بأي شكل من الأشكال. تنظم القتل والخراب والدمار، عقليات مخربة لا ترى
a very corrupted ideology that is no humanity to ISIS, and today is trying to oppress the human being in our modern world. Today they are trying to sell women, sell children. This is a very heinous crime that they do sell women and children in Iraq and Syria. This terrorist group must be decimated, must be completely killed, and what we have achieved in Iraq is that we forever can destroy and decimate this terrorist group by being allies, by unifying our efforts and remaining focused on destroying and decimating Daesh, and not to be distracted by regional differences and regional conflicts. In Iraq, as we decentralized, and since 2.5 years after our government has come to place, we made many efforts to provide many powers to the various governorates. We have a local council in every governorate, and we have a governor who is elected, and we deal with the local councils and the governors as the local government. This centralization strengthens Iraq, and we provide more powers and more authorities. We are committed to that.
وأننا قمنا بمشروع كبير من أجل إعادة الاستقرار وإعادة الاستقرار وإعادة الخدمات الأساسية لهذه المناطق المحررة من خلال دعم الحكومة الاتحادية وكذلك إنشاء لجان رأسية في كل محافظة تحت رعاية المحافظ من أجل تطبيق هذه المشاريع بسرعة. وبالفعل من خلال هذا التعاون الكبير تمكننا من تحقيق نجاح في عودة المواطنين أو النازحين إلى منازلهم وإلى بيوتهم. والآن توجد هناك حركة اقتصادية كبيرة في هذه المدن التي تم تحريرها، لأن عودة المواطنين تمكنهم من القيام بأعمالهم والقيام بنشاطهم الاقتصادي والقيام بأمور تخص الاقتصاد وتدعم الحركة الاقتصادية. وخلال سنتين والنصف بالرغم من وجود إرهاب داعش لقد زاد العراق من إنتاج النفط، والآن العراق يمكن أن يصل إلى سقف 5 ملايين برميل يوميا من الإنتاج النفطي. وبالرغم من كلفة الحرب وبالرغم من تدمير الحرب، لكن هذا لا يمنعنا من التقدم في مجالات أخرى وتزويد الخدمات للمواطنين وتقديم الدعم لهم. وفي العراق منذ 20 شهر هناك مظاهرات تكاد تكون بشكل يومي من مختلف المواطنين في العراق يطالبون بحقوق ويعبرون عن وجهة نظرهم ونحن نحترم ذلك. الديمقراطية في العراق الآن تحترم إرادة المواطن، والأجهزة والقوات الأمنية توفر الحماية لهؤلاء المواطنين الذين يعبرون عن رأيهم ما داموا يلتزمون بالقانون وما داموا يلتزمون بحقوق المواطنين وعدم الاعتداء على الأملاك العامة والأملاك الخاصة للمواطنين. وهذا تطور كبير في بلد كان يقمع وكان يحاسب الإنسان ويحكم بالإعدام على مجرد أن يكتب مشهوراً معارضاً للنظام أو مجرد أن ينتقد رأس النظام. وهذا التقدم الذي حققناه في العراق نأمل أن يعم بشكل أكبر وأن يتم توفير مثل هذه الحرية في باقي المناطق. نحن ننتصر على داعش بديمقراطيتنا، وننتصر على داعش بتماسكنا ووحدتنا، وننتصر على داعش بتنوعنا. داعش ترفض التنوع وتقتل الذين يختلفون معهم والذين لا يمثلون ما يعتقدون به. ونحن نثبت للآخرين أننا موحدون رغم الاختلاف في وجهات نظرنا ورغم تعدد انتماءاتنا. العراق منذ أن أنشئ ومنذ القدم يوجد فيه مثل هذا التنوع وعاش لمئات القرون وفق هذا التنوع. وأضرب مثالا أن الملوية التي في سامراء التي بنيت قبل 1000 عام وخضعت لاحتلال المغول واحتلال غيرهم وبقت صامدة، ولكن أثناء تواجد القاعدة قبل داعش تم تدميرها في الأعلى وتفجيرها إلى الأعلى. وهذا يدلل حجم التدمير الذي تسببه هذه الجماعات الإرهابية والتي لا يمكن السماح لها بالبقاء. أنا أرجو أن نتفق على تعريف مشترك بأن هذه المنظمة الإرهابية والمنظمات المشابهة الإرهابية من غير الصحيح. أنا أعتبر داعش منظمة إرهابية عندما تعمل ضدي ولا أعتبرها منظمة إرهابية عندما تقوم بأعمال إرهابية في المناطق الأخرى. يجب أن نكون موحدين. الخطر الداعشي والخطر الإرهابي يأم المنطقة إذا تسامحنا منه وإذا تساهلنا معه. يجب أن نتوحد القضاء على داعش ويمكننا اليوم القضاء على داعش في هذا الإطار. Threat and in this scope we must destroy ISIS. If we continuously cooperate, and I call on everybody in this global coalition to continue the cooperation to decimate Daesh and not continue it. We are able to kill Daesh and destroy it in this final stage. Also, as we fight this war, we started a program of reform in Iraq to simplify all procedural and bureaucratic procedures in Iraq, and also fighting corruption.
أن يعرفوا أين تذهب الثروة التي تملأ الثروة العراقية والنفط العراقي لجميع العراقيين وليس لفئة دول أخرى وليس لحاكم دول المواطنين وليس لمنطقة دول أخرى هذه الثروة لكل العراقيين باختلاف انتماءاتهم وتوجهاتهم ونحن حريصون على محاربة الإرهاب إن الإرهاب آفة كما قلنا في العراق آفة لا تقل خطورة عن الإرهاب إن الفساد آفة لا تقل خطورة عن الإرهاب مطلقا لأنها تسرق
as dangerous as terrorism
وتؤدي الى تداعيات خطيره
leads to very dangerous consequences.
بعض قطاعات الجيش العراقي وانهيار المقاومه العراقيه عند دخول داعش الى العراق احد اهم اسباب الفساد لا يمكن للمقاتل ولا يمكن للجندي ان يقاتل اذا راى ان قائده والنظام cannot fight if he sees his officer ولا يمكن للموظف ان يعمل بجد واخلاص اذا راى ان مسؤوله فاسد ولهذا محاربه الفساد اعلم انها ليست سهله ونعلم ان لها محاربون كثر ولكن هناك فساد ربما
is an institutional corruption as well and has been festering for a long time. However, we are determined to eradicate it in order to rid Iraq of this evil. Corruption and terrorism are a common plague
and we are cooperating هدف الإرهابيين بشكل مباشر
to fight against the goal of the terrorists or try to use corruption to further their goals. We are determined to fight ISIS. That is an Iraqi today force fighting the counter-terrorism unit of the Iraqi army and the Peshmerga with us for the first time in the history of Iraq, fighting side by side. Today, Iraqis are fighting side by side with the Peshmergas, not against each other, but together.
ليس هو قتال مصلحي كان البعض يتصور مصلحي ولكن العلاقة بين الطرفين خلال هذه الأشهر الماضية كانت علاقة جيدة وممتازة وهناك تعاون كبير وتفاهم كبير وأستطيع أقول بجد أن قواتنا الأمنية العراقية حصلت على احترام مواطنيها لأننا نعمل من أجل كل المواطنين وهذا هو توجهنا إلى قواتنا الأمنية وتوجهاتنا إلى قواتنا العسكرية وإلى كل التشكيلات الإرهابية الأخرى بأن هدفها حماية المواطن وليس قمع المواطن توفير الأمن للمواطن إبعاد الشرع المواطن ونحن نحاسب على كل تجاوز ممكن أن نثبته بالقانون على حقوق الإنسان وعلى كرامة المواطنين وقد أثبتنا أننا نحاسب على ذلك وبالفعل قمنا بهذه المحاسبة كما أن هناك متطوعين من أبناء الشعب العراقي شاركوا في هذا القتال من مختلف فئات الشعب العراقي من السنة من الشيعة من التركمان من المسيحيين من الأزيديين من الشبك ومن كل المحافظات شاركوا في القتال جنبا إلى جنب مع قواتنا الأمنية وتحت قيادة قواتنا الأمنية من أجل طرد داعش إن مجلس النواب العراقي قام بتشريع قانون الحج الشعبي
Also, وقانون الحج الشعبي
حسب ما قرره مجلس النواب يتألف أن هذا الحج الشعبي يكون تحت قيادة الدولة قيادة القادة العام للقوات المسلحة والذي هو رئيس الوزراء وأن الحج الشعبي ضمن منظومة الدولة العراقية تنطبق عليها الأنظمة العسكرية العراقية والانضباط العراقي في المؤسسة العسكرية وكذلك لا يجوز
باعتبارها جهاز أمني عسكري لا يجوز لها أن تدمج السياسة بالجانب العسكري والجانب الأمني وهذا أمر مهم لأننا مقبلون على انتخابات محلية ومقبلون على انتخابات برلمانية في العام القادم ولا يجوز ولا ينبغي لفئات سياسية تحمل السلاح أن تخوض هذه الانتخابات يجب فصل السلاح عن الجانب السياسي ولا يجوز أن يكون أي سلاح خاطئ خارج إطار الدولة الدستور العراقي نص بصراحة أن لا وجود لجماعات مسلحة خارج إطار الدولة والذين يحملون السلاح خارج إطار الدولة يعتبرون خارجين عن القانون والمواجهون وبالتالي قانون الحشد الشعبي يأتي بهؤلاء المقاتلين الذين قاتلوا بشجاعة والذين قاتلوا ببسالة والذين ضحوا بأنفسهم وضحوا بما يملكون من أجل الدفاع عن الوطن ومن أجل الدفاع عن العراقيين يكونوا ضمن هذه المنظومة تحت القيادة العراقية وضمن القانون العراقي ولا يسمح لآخر بحمل السلاح خارج هذه المنظومة ونحن حريصون على استيعاب كل المواطنين من أجل عزة هذا البلد ومن أجل القضاء على الإرهاب أستاذ الحضور الإرهاب لا يهدد العراق كما رأيتم يهدد المنطقة بل يهدد العالم.
This threat threatens the entire world, the entire second region. Just like you said, Mr. Secretary, this heinous terrorism is very dangerous. This is a very dangerous group. We were talking about Al Qaeda and its terrorism, and the Al-Qaeda groups are still there. Now we have moved to the terrorism of ISIS, very dangerous.
Terrorism.
Other
علينا
groups,
القضاء على هذا الإرهاب
we must
لأنه لا يدعنا أن نتقدم
combat and decimate this threat
يستنزف طاقاتنا
and this terror because it's draining our resources, draining our efforts and draining our economic means and preventing economic progress and modernity.
إرهاب
we must fight terror and terrorism and that requires us to change our way of doing things and our way of governing.
Terrorism
is exploiting the injustice that is happening in the region and exploiting the regional conflict that is happening in the region. When there is a regional conflict that is void and where are the regions that are suffering from void, terrorism will exploit. Therefore, I call
on
containing the regional differences and the regional conflicts because these are the main one of the main reasons to seeing these groups rise that in Syria and Libya and other places
where
these groups are rising
بكل الدعم الذي يقدم لنا
we welcome all the support
ونشكر هذا الدعم الذي يقدم
للعراق to Iraq
من قبل التحالف الدولي
everyone who supports in the global coalition that supports Iraq. This coalition proved that we can fight together terrorism. We all have common interests. Iraq is not begging for support and is not asking for support from a position of weakness, but we all are asking for it all together, all in the same boat, all on the same ship facing this terrorism. And we fight side by side on the ground, and we benefit from all the logistical support and all the air support that is being given to us and to our forces as we move forward to the next phase to protect our borders and rebuild our countries.
Our country,
we have the means to deal with that. We have absorbed and we're working with all the components of Iraq. I can't pretend that we have resolved all our issues, but these problems go back to many years in the past when Saddam and the Ba'ath regime oppressed the Iraqi people and fought many wars in the region and destroyed the means of the Iraqi people until 2003 and the heinous terrorist attacks by the terrorists on Iraq who came from around 100 countries from all over the world. We have to cooperate to contain these and destroy these terrorism and these terrorists and prevent them from expanding their efforts and again not containing ISIS but destroy and decimate Daesh. And thank you, peace of God be upon you all. Thank you for listening.